Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, first session I would like to introduce Dr. Mahil Devarez. I hope it is correct. It's a close to correct pronunciation. Yeah. Because Dr. Mahil is my good friend for a long time. Okay, and because he's a professor from the Netherlands. Redbank University, Department of the Public Administration. Also, he's a current president of the International Association of the School and the Institute of the Administration. Today, he wants to give us the topic, the public sector, and we can see from the PowerPoint, the public sector and the civil society. There are somewhat neglected issues, so we like to hear what's the issues that be neglected. Okay, let's welcome Mahil. Thank you.
Thank you so much for inviting me to this conference, and I'm humbled by being the keynote speaker. It's high expectations, and I can only be disappointing, you know, when you have such high expectations. There's only one way it goes bad. So, but I thank you anyway. I'm honored, I'm humbled by this invitation. And to be in Taiwan, because Taiwan is a beautiful country. I come from Holland, which is hours and hours away, but we have some similarities. We are small countries, we have big neighbors. This is beautiful, this is a green country, lovely, and I'm really happy to be here. So, I start my speech. Okay, let's see. My main points, just to make it clear, My main points, there are different roles for civil society, and there are different points to investigate. And the last decades witnessed reforms in the public sector, in which the publicness of public administration was seriously neglected. It was all about the administration side and not about the public side. And furthermore, that's my final point, such reforms have negative side effects. If you keep on reforming, the public administration will become more and more internally oriented and will neglect civil society and public participation more and more and will only think about its own self-interest instead of the interest of society. Because people are afraid, there is uncertainty, there's fear of being fired, fear of getting different bosses, fear of everything. And that makes you only think about yourself and neglect civil society. So my final point, I say it already, if you want to involve, if you want to construct a civil society, you need to involve societal groups. And in order to involve societal groups, you have to have an external orientation. And that external orientation, according to me, but I always put it more sharply in order to get a good discussion, that external orientation was destroyed by the many multiple repeated reforms that took place in the last two decades. Reforms that go on and on and on and that make people, public officials, only think about their own position. How will it change? What will happen? So, my final point is, if you want a civil society, stop administrative reforms. Yeah, that's my main point. But we can discuss it. We can discuss. I know it's to be disputed, but that's the nice thing. Conferences are there to discuss things. And I want to put it extra sharp, especially sharp, in order to make that discussion possible. Okay? So, societal groups can be seen in different roles. First, they can be seen as a target group, the target of policy making. We want to control society. We see societal groups as the enemy that is always inclined to do bad things. And we, as a public administration, have to control, monitor what's going on in society. We have to put sanctions on bad behavior. Then society is the target of public policy. Another role of society is that it's an interest group. It has interest, it has special interest, and there are multiple interests from the unions, from the employers, from all groups you can imagine. And are they involved in policy making? Can they make their interests clear? And is that interest, are those interests included in the policies that are developed? The third role is society as the client. And then you only talk about service delivery. And then every person in society, every individual is just a client, getting a passport quickly, efficiently, getting a driver's license quickly, getting the garbage collected efficiently and effectively. They are clients. And public administration, government, is just the seller of the goods. And the last possible role of society is that it's a partner. That you include society in making policies, in implementing policies. That you say, well, we do it together. Not we, government, alone, but together with society. So there are four possible roles for society. And the first one, societal groups as a target group, assumes some antagonism between government and society. It's about control. You have to control those nasty people, possible terrorists. You have to control them. You have to make all kinds of measures to monitor, because the interests of society and government are really different. That's the assumption. And there is some hierarchy. Societal groups are subject to governmental policies. Not equal, but there's hierarchy. Some people are controlling, some people are controlled. Then the society is the target group. If you have society as an interest group, it's much more horizontal. You know, you talk together with employers, unions, environmental groups, citizens, individual citizens, universities, you involve them in policy making, despite the difference of interest, because unions really have different interests from employers. But you listen to all of them and then come up with a kind of policy. The third one, number C, society as clients, you assume that there is a common interest of good, efficient, effective service delivery. But there is a hierarchy. Some organization delivers, some individual or group buys the service. And then the fourth, that's the public management model mainly, you know? New public management model in which the citizen is the client, in which society is the client. And the last one is societal groups as partners. And that's the governance model, in which there's no hierarchy, it's horizontal, and there is supposedly congruence of interest, that you do it together. A prime example is public-private partnerships. That's one example of that last model. But also to involve citizens as equals in order to make policies, to implement policies, to do it together. That's the governance model. So, if you want to construct civil society, you have to make a choice. How do we see that society? You cannot have it all simultaneously. That's nearly impossible, because then you get half-hearted policies. But we can discuss it later. So you have to choose. How do we see society as a government? Do we see them as a target for our policies? Do we see them as interest groups, having specific interests and being involved in order to accommodate all those interests? Do we see them just as clients or do we see them as partners? How do we see them? And institutionalization, you can see how the society is viewed upon. You see it in the procedural measures, you see it in the information measures, in the consultative measures, in institutional measures, and in restructuring measures. Now, this is a very complex slide. This is a very complex slide. And I lose the light here, so I have difficulty of reading. But when you look at societal groups as target groups, then you take measures in order to regulate, extensive regulation, maintenance by sanctions. You know, but if you see society as an interest group, you regulate in order to ensure democratization. That's something different. Laws on work councils, for instance. You enable the existence, the creation of work councils, of public inquiry procedures, of constitutional rights, of freedom of the press. That's indicative for a society that takes its, of a government that takes its society as an interest group, that has interest and the interest has to be uttered. When you see societal groups as a client, you aim at simplification of regulation, you aim at deregulation, you aim at language improvement, you aim at the redesign of forms in order to have everybody understand what they need to do, staff training to enhance efficiency, etc. Then you see them as clients. That's an institution building when you want to see society as a client. And when you see them as partners, you have negotiated agreements. You don't say, this is the law, but you say, how can we make an agreement, a gentleman's agreement, in order to get things going, in order for you to be doing the things we all want to do. And that's different. Self-regulation instead of laws. And according and it, in information measures, you see the same. Regarding target groups, you have registration, sociographic and demographic research, information as a means of governmental control. That's indicative for a society in which the government sees that society as a target group. But in a society in which societal groups are seen as interest groups, you have freedom of information and you try to ensure that. You have hearings before you make a policy. You have public meetings, community outreach, committees, forums, referenda, and then information is a right for societal groups. Information exchange is a right for societal groups. And when you see societal groups as clients, you just have polls. You know, how satisfied are you with the service delivery? Advertising, brochures, guides, public relations advice, surveys, information as a communication service. And when you see societal groups as partners, you have deliberation. You're going to sit around the table and you're going to deliberate what is going to be done. Joint project teams, lobbying, negotiation, information as a means for mutual understanding. And when you see at the institutional measures, you see national statistical and planning agencies when you see society as a target group, because you want to know about society for your control. But if you see society as a number of interest groups, you work councils, appeal courts, tribunals. And if you see society as a client, you build an ombudsman in order to give society a means to complain about the service delivery. Or you have special committees. And in societal groups as partners, you have consultative bodies, national boards, in which everybody is involved. And you see that in public-private partnerships, for instance. Okay, and as clients, you see the emergence of one-shop systems. Okay. And then it's possible to give an explanation who is involved and why are they involved. Who is involved in policy making? Who is involved in policy implementation? And why are they involved? What are the assumptions? Are the societal groups seen as enemies of the state or as friends of the states? Do we see a hierarchy or do we see horizontal relations? And that you can, then you can make a distinction and then you can explain and you can do research. In what society is Taiwan? In what society is Holland? And you think maybe that Holland, the partnership model is now dominant. It's not. At present, in the Netherlands, the target group perspective is dominant. Because as other countries, we are really afraid of extremism, terrorism, etc. So we have a lot of controls, a lot of information gathered just to control those possibly potential extremist groups. That's the main thing nowadays in the Netherlands. But institutions vary, and if you want to involve society, you have to choose what kind of role do we want to give to society. That's one. And then you can ask questions, when do we involve civil society in that policy-making process? Early in the process, late in the process, during the whole process, what do we want? And what's effective, what's ineffective? What's efficient, what's inefficient? And how to involve stakeholders? Still one of the main questions, major questions, how to enable larger groups of societal actors who have their say. You know, you can sit around the table with 15 persons, but do they represent society? Do they represent the whole community? That's the question. If you want to involve the whole community, how to do that? That's a real problem. And we have, of course, the ICT nowadays. We can use ICT, information and communication technology. But is that the way it should be done? That's the question. And there is no single way to involve all the actors. So my first reflection. Needed is theory-driven, systematic, empirical research. I'm talking to scholars, I heard, into the explanation of the variance of public sector reforms and how it includes the society, into the actual occurrence of expected impacts of including civil society in policy process. What does it mean for a policy that you have included society? Is it just one step, as one alderman in Holland said to me, I involve societal groups very early in the process, then it's done with and I can go my way. You know, that's one way to do it, but it's not a good way to do it. Then you don't take society very seriously. Second thing, we have seen many public reform, public administration reforms the last decades. Many, I think in Taiwan also, I don't know for sure. Who says there have not been any reforms in the administrative reforms in Taiwan? There have been, eh? Yeah, I hope so, yeah, because otherwise my point fails. And especially the new public management reforms. Have they been here in Taiwan also? The new public management reforms? Yes, okay. Then I can make my point. Yeah, two variants of new public management, American and European. And I don't know which one was dominant in Taiwan, but the American one is by Osborne and Gabler. Government and the NPM should follow those 10 rules you all know. You know, you have all heard about. Enterprising, anticipatory. And it says, indeed, government itself is the problem. Leave as much as possible to the free market and see civil society as a customer, as a client. That's the main point I got from that new public management in the American version. In the European version, Christopher Hood is dominant, and he says government should pursue all kinds of things in order to improve itself internally, with an emphasis on output and efficiency. It's not that government is the problem, but it's the way that government does it that is a problem, and we should improve the internal workings of government. While the American version is much more, we should discard of government, we should leave everything to the free market as a basic principle. So the American version of new public management, less government, more market. The European version of NPM, more efficient, output-oriented government. And there's nothing wrong with that. I like efficiency, I like output, but not only that, you know. Because if you see the different things that government has to do, it has to be efficient, it has to have a decent process, a due process, it has to achieve its goals, but it also has to arrive at outcomes. And you can have a dominant government, a dominant market, or you can have a mixed dominance. And what you see in NPM is that it all goes this way. Market dominance with an emphasis on efficiency and output. That's the NPM way. And now, that was so for the last years. And now we ask, is NPM still going on or is it passé? Many have argued that NPM is passé, no longer alive. We can argue about that, we can discuss that. But what has come in its place? Well, according to the first dimension, some people say there's more government now. Government is getting its proper place as a dominant actor in society back. Because of all the problems, the international threats, the financial crisis, in which it's said at least that there was too little control of government over the banking system. So government gets its place back. That's one thing. And the second dimension is that there is a return of emphasis on efficiency and output towards process and outcomes. That's the second trend, I see. But it's seen in different views. First, developmental state. For instance, in South Africa. You know, they say government should protect its domestic industry. It's not about attracting as many foreign investors as possible. You have key industry in your country, and government should protect that key industry. And that key industry should not strive for maximum profits, it should strive for maximum market shares, which is something different, in order to have as many employees as possible, to attract as many workers as possible, in order to avoid unemployment. You should have a strong key industry, and the government should ensure that. Should ensure that it is not taken over by foreign investors. That's the main thing of the developmental state. And they don't want capital transfer. It is not needed. So many foreign direct investment not needed in the developmental state, as it's seen in South Africa nowadays. And corporatism. Working together, government and market. Not leaving everything to the market, but working together with the market. It's a kind of partnership. And output legitimacy, effectiveness, is more important than input legitimacy, efficiency. And economic growth is more important than political and administrative reform. We need economic growth. That's the developmental state. That's one of the alternatives popular nowadays as a successor of new public management. And there you see it in the model. You see from market dominance, you see a trend towards mixed dominance, government and market doing it together, and not efficiency and output, but outcomes. Outcomes are the most important in that new developmental state. It's not how you do it. We don't care if you do it transparent or intransparent, no problem. Who cares, anyway? Whether you are accountable or not, who cares? The only thing you care about is about the outcomes. What is good for society as a whole? That's the thing that's crucial in the developmental state. Not how you do it, not the process. Outcomes. Okay? That's one way to go. But still, the focus is on business, and there's hardly a role for the rest of civil society. There's public-private partnership, but limited to business. There's also the idea of the Neo-Iberian state, and Wolfgang Drexler, he's not yet here. I think his plane is also delayed, like my plane yesterday from China, arriving 1 hour late. But he's one of the supporters of the Neo-Iberian state. And it says, we need a reaffirmation of the role of the state as the main facilitator of solutions to the new emergent problems. Of a representative democracy as the legitimating element of administrative law in preserving the basic principles and of the idea of a public service with a distinct status and culture, distinct from the private sector, really distinct. With, and that's classical Weberian, Max Weber, you know, and the neo elements are that there should be a shift from an internal towards an external orientation. Consultation with and direct representation of citizens' view. A modernization of the relevant laws and professionalization of the civil service. So what we see is that that model proposes to have a government that's dominant over society. A public sector that's dominant over society. But still, efficiency and output as main emphasis. That's the main emphasis. And still, the main focus remains on the internal workings of government. Societal groups are mainly involved as customers to improve the performance of the public sector. Still. And then there's the total disappointment in new public management. You know, in Hungary is exemplary. Back to state control, do away with the free market. Back to the old communist system. Back to total control, the process and the outcomes are based and developed by government on its own. No role for civil society whatsoever. Civil society not included. And then what we see in Europe nowadays is enforced new public management because of the financial crisis. Further cutbacks, further privatization, further increase of the dominant role of the market, and simultaneously increased governmental regulation over those banking systems, etc. There we see this. From a mixed system, we go to further market dominance. Because of the financial crisis, it's not affordable anymore. Still, there's nothing in it for civil society. And then we have the reaction in good governance. Outcomes-oriented, process-oriented. Government should do what it's supposed to do, to create security, to protect property rights, to reduce societal problems, and to take back its leading role in controlling and steering societal developments. But it's mainly process-oriented. Legitimacy and voice, direction, performance, accountability, fairness, rule of law. It's how you do it. You know, it's Ella Fitzgerald. It ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. As if what you do doesn't matter. It's only how you do it that matters. Do it transparent, do it accountable. And I always wonder, was Ella Fitzgerald right? I don't know. It ain't what you do, it's the way that you do it. I don't know if that's correct. I think outcomes are important also. You know, but this is really from mixed, from market dominance to mixed and process-oriented good governance. But there is a role for civil society. But the importance of civil society is buried under the amount of requirements good governance has to fulfill. I don't know, does any one of you know the World Governance Indicators as made by the World Bank? 160 indicators, at least. You know, they say six dimensions, but the dimension, the way they measure it, it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming. And civil society, the role of civil, it's only one of those indicators. So I'm not too happy. Second reflections, public values have only a minor role in dominant reforms. An external orientation, a true public service motivation was hardly encouraged by the reforms in the last decades, according to me. But we can discuss. So the third point, last point, the negative impact of reform. I'm not just saying that the reforms neglected a public service motivation and the real role for civil society. I will now argue that it even has a negative effect on that role of civil society. That's the last point I want to make. You know? This is what I saw last week in a United States newspaper. The endless urge to reform Washington. landmark commissions aimed at making government work better come and go, typically expiring with little follow-up. We need to reform the way we reform. So now we're not just reforming government, but we are reforming the way we reform government. You know? It's all about reform. Reform, reform, reform. With the most magnificent aims and goals. Make government work better. Save money. Address pressing problems. Strengthen and to create better society, they say. Achieving good governance, reinvent government, engage public sector clients, reduce corruption, enforce cooperation. Whatever, whatever, whatever. You know, it's like my daughter. Whenever she has a problem in school, with boyfriends, whatever, she says, I go shopping. Yeah? The same way, it's the same we do. Whatever the problem, administrative reform is the problem, is the solution. And I don't know, I don't see the empirical evidence that there is a causal link between administrative reform and the solution of societal problems. I don't see it. But maybe here you have done that research, I don't know. And the outcomes are disappointing, have always been disappointing. In the 1990s, Thomas called for the empirical evidence of effects of reorganization complicated. That's diplomacy. He really said, we don't find any evidence of effectiveness of reorganizations. And so he says, diplomatic, it's complicated. In the 1990s, Cuban labeled reorganizations as tinkering towards utopia. And you know, utopia does not exist. And as recent as 2 years ago, Savoy asked the question whether the capacity of the public sector, their decision-making ability, its efficiency have increased because of the sequence of reforms and reorganizations. And his answer, a clear no. No. So, research questions. I don't care about the effectiveness of reforms as such. I have asked myself the question, what do those reforms imply for the employees in the public sector? What do they imply for public officials to experience reform after reform? And the way I ask the question pushes the answer, of course. Until now, most scholars have addressed the macro effects. I'm going into those micro effects, officials' morale. And this is my model. This is my model. What I say is that reforms result in uncertainty. Uncertainty about the changing hierarchical relations. Who is going to be my boss? What about my own position? And it's also a violation of the psychological contract, what's called psychological contract, the expectation the organization has about the employee and the expectation the employee has about your organization. It changes. That's one thing. And that results in uncertainty. And the second thing, reforms result in physical, emotional, and psychological strain. There's a lot of research that says that blood pressure of employees goes up in times of reorganizations and reforms. And that, ladies and gentlemen, affects the world work morale. Public service motivation, that you see society, that you see a role for civil society, it declines in times of reforms. Pride. You know, we ask the question, do you dare to tell your friends where you work? We ask that of public officials. Do you dare to tell them? Do you dare to tell them what you do for work? Your friends? Many people in the public sector don't dare to tell their friends anymore where they work because they are ashamed. Yes, they are ashamed of their work and the working condition and the image it has. And it's not only tax officers, it's also police officers. It's people working for national government, municipalities. They feel ashamed for what they do. They have no pride in their work anymore. Second thing, job satisfaction. job satisfaction goes down in times of reforms. And that results in resisting further reforms, conservatism, and disturbed interpersonal relations. You know, if there's a reform, and there are new hierarchical conditions, and you and your colleague both are applying for that upper function, what happens? You start gossiping about one another. You start criticizing one another. You start arguing with one another. And then there is interpersonal conflict. But this is all theory. I did some research on that. Outcomes on job satisfaction. We asked those, this is about Holland mainly, but I don't think it's special for Holland. Whether we asked public officials whether they doubt they can keep their job, whether there's certainty about keeping their job. And those officials that were uncertain about their job, they showed less job satisfaction. They showed less satisfaction with the organization they are working for. They were less positive about politicians and policy. They show less public service motivation, and that's important. They don't care about the public service anymore. They don't care about the public anymore. They don't care about society anymore. They only care about their own jobs. They only are concerned about their own jobs. Less affinity with their organization, less pride in their organization because of the multiple repeated reforms. Interpersonal conflicts. What I found is that it was one of the most important problems in the municipalities in the Netherlands. Not in provinces, but in municipalities. People fighting among one another. You know, John is making a proposal and Peter says no. Why does Peter say no? Because it's a bad proposal? No. Because the proposal comes from John. And he hates John. And whatever John says, he will disagree. And we see that in municipalities. And what we see also in municipalities is that there are continuous and repeated reforms over the last 20 years in Holland. And in the provinces, everything remains stable. Hardly any reform. And in the provinces, we don't see those interpersonal conflicts. We see business conflicts. We see substantial conflicts. But we don't see interpersonal conflicts. But we see those in municipalities. And it's not just conflict. They are really impeding on the development of new public policies. There are no public policies developed because of those interpersonal conflicts. And then the last thing, conservatism. We asked those provincial and municipal officials also, what do you think about these policy areas, 15 policy areas? Who should have prime responsibility? National government, provincial government, or local government? And the provincial officials, they said, give everything to us. You know, as a good strategic official should say. We want to have prime responsibility over everything. But the local officials from the municipalities, which has experienced so many reforms, they said, oh, please leave it as it is. We don't care if others have the responsibility. Leave the arrangements as they are. They showed real conservatism. Okay. Conclusions. All this suggests that public sector reforms can be seen as gambles in which organizations within the public sector are put at stake. And if the reform succeeds, there's added value. But as we argued, as I argued, if it doesn't, there's a loss, probably even higher than the expected gains from reforms. And statistical reasoning then says, don't do it. And this is not a conservative point of view. I'm not a conservative. Maybe you see me as a conservative now. But what I am saying is, if you have multiple repeated reforms, you create conservatives in the public sector. People who don't care about the public anymore. That's my big problem. Repeated reforms. You know, when I use the word reform in Holland, people immediately say, oh no, not again. Please, no, not again. And they start to become so conservative. And we don't want conservative public administrators. We want administrators that include the society, that have an eye for society, that have the interests of society as their first priority instead of their own personal position within the organization. Conservative public administrators is the last thing we need. So, do I have another slide? Now you can say boo. Okay.